Continuing our series on configuring business intelligence, in this video we're going to look at configuring Excel services. So Excel services allows us to view and interact with Excel workbooks via the browser. I very carefully not said edit. If you need to edit these, then what you need is Excel on your desktop or Office web apps installed. Now we've already got a server configured for that. So Excel services is something different. So the first step is let's go to manage services on server and, as usual, start the service on server before we start creating the service application. So that's now started. So let's go to app management, then down to manage service apps and create a new Excel services application. We can potentially give it a new application pool and give it a managed account to run with, and then choose to add it to the farm's default proxy group. So that's created along with its proxy. If I select the row, I can hit administrators. We can obviously devolve the configuration of this to other users. If I click on the link itself, then we get to configure Excel services itself. So starting at the top, we have global settings. Here we can configure how SharePoint is allowed to access workbooks. Impersonation means it will either use a claims, Kerberos, or secure store service approach. Process account means it will use the account that runs the service application itself, the app pool. Next is encryption required to get at stuff. Will we allow cross-domain access between HTTP domains? Good idea to leave that off. Then load balancing, if you have more than one server running Excel services, will it be per workbook URL? Is it going to be round robin with a health check or local server only? Then how many sessions per user? Maximum private bytes and cache threshold and memory settings. Lots more cache settings, workbook cache location. How long should a connection last in seconds? Then optionally the analysis services effective username. Now that's a way of delegating the end user's Windows credentials to a SQL Server analysis services box. And then moving further down, we have the unattended service account. Now this has evolved slightly from 2010. In 2010, you would specify the name of a secure store service application that you've previously created. For instance, we could have got it to use assets, the one we created a little while ago. I can do that here by saying use an existing one and put that in here. However, new in 2013, it's brought it in line with how Performance Point sets up the same configuration. In Performance Point, you would key in a username and password, and it would then create the target application in the secure store for you. Well, Excel now gives you that option as well. So let's try this. So if I wanted to use Contoso/SP service apps with our favorite password, I can do this and it will then create for me a uniquely named target application. So let's see what it's done. I'm going to go back to application management in a new tab, and then over to manage service apps, and down to secure store service. And notice how we now have the Excel services application unattended service account, and it's created that as a group. Let's just fill this in, so that the account running Excel services application pool is the member of this group. So that's effectively everyone who can use Excel services will be signed in with the credentials that we've set. Now we set this via Excel, so I don't need to go through that step here. So next, back in Excel services configuration, if we go to trusted file locations, we can tell SharePoint where we will trust it to load workbooks from. So the default rule in SharePoint 2013's version of Excel services is all SharePoint sources are trusted, all document libraries in any web application that you specify. If you wanted to lock that down a bit more, you'd edit this and put in the full path to a document library, a folder, or a site, or a site collection, or a whole web app, or in this case, an entire protocol, and then Microsoft SharePoint Foundation as the type. You can also specify UNC and other HTTP sources, so file shares and other websites, and whether it should recurse and trust children underneath, so that's subfolders and so on. Then we have things like session timeouts, maximum workbook sizes it's going to load, the volatile function cache lifetime. Now, if you've got developers who have written user-defined functions in .NET, and we've deployed those, if they've got maybe, I don't know, a function that's generating a time or a random number, let's say, and you're getting a suspicious run of identical data from them, it probably means it's treated it as a volatile function and cached that for 300 seconds. So this setting will let you change how long that's cached. Next, do we allow external data? That's a biggie. By default, it's trusted only data connection libraries that we specify elsewhere. Now, this is different from trusted data sources. This is different from trusted file locations. These are places where we can upload a data connection file that users can then use in their own Excel services workbooks. That way, as admin, we have control over what data sources people are using to bring into SharePoint. Personally, I don't like the embedded option. I would go for data connection libraries only. None will take away a lot of the usefulness here and mean that users can't connect Excel workbooks to external data in databases, etc., outside SharePoint. So the middle one is probably the lowest level of functionality you actually want to give out, and embedded, well, that depends upon your users. That means they can put in a connection string of their choice in their workbooks, and our servers will then connect to that source. If I scroll further down, we have cache lifetime, how long it will keep data, concurrent queries per session, and do we allow REST data? And do we allow that data to be refreshed? Now, this means that, for instance, users could bring in data from arbitrary SharePoint lists via the REST API. That's quite useful. Lastly, do we allow user-defined functions? So users can only use user-defined functions that we've trusted. So we'll see that in a moment. Next, trusted data providers. These are all the .NET data providers that are trusted by default. If you wanted to trust connections to MySQL, let's say, you would install the MySQL provider and then add that provider by name here. Next, we have trusted data connection libraries, and these are the locations I mentioned earlier where you can upload a UDCX or an ODC Office Data Connectivity file. So you'd key in the full URL to a document library of type data connection library. Let's go back again. Under use-defined function assemblies, I can tell SharePoint the location to a folder. So here we can put in the path to a trusted user-defined assembly that we'd like SharePoint to load. Alternatively, we could paste in the strong name of that assembly in the global assembly cache. So we have a choice of path or GAC, then whether it's enabled or not. Lastly, data model settings. And this is new in SharePoint 2013, and it allows us to key in the name of a SQL Server Analysis Services box. And that requires SSAS 2012 Service Pack 1 or newer, and it's got to be installed in SharePoint integrated deployment mode. So that's configuring Excel services. Let's have a look at some of this functionality from a user's perspective. So let's create a new site collection to use some of the BI functionality. If I go to Application Management and then Create Site Collections, under our intranet web application, let's create a place I'm going to call the BI Hub, the Business Intelligence Hub, and I'm going to pick a particular template. Let's go with the Business Intelligence Center template. I'm going to make Spadmin the administrator. And let's say OK. That'll take a moment or several. And that reckons that's created. So let's open that up in a new tab. And here's our new 2013 Business Intelligence Center. So this is a site collection created from a template. It turns on things like the publishing infrastructure and the performance point features and a few other features at the site collection and site level that we're going to need. It's also created for us a library called the Data Connections Library. And this is where I would create or upload Office data connectivity files. Incidentally, you'd make one of those perhaps in Office using Excel on the desktop. On the data tab, you could connect to an external database and then save that connection string as an ODC file. The Excel end of that is obviously beyond the scope of this video, but here's where you'd upload the ODC file. And you need to tell Excel services on the central admin pages we've seen over the course of this video. If I head over to Libraries and then Documents, we have a sample workbook. If I click on this, it will open it in the browser, but not using Office web apps. Instead, it will use Excel services to render this. And here we have our Excel services 2013 view. We have a graph here that's all 3D. That's new in 2013. We have slices for slicing through our pivot table in various different angles. If I scroll down, you can see we also have in-cell spark lines showing the trend, various different traffic light and in-cell bar chart effects. This particular sample spreadsheet is getting all its data from other worksheets in the workbook. So in this video, we had a look at creating the Excel services service application, securing it via the secure store service, and then creating a sample site using the Business Intelligence Center. And we saw an Excel services workbook rendered in the browser.